Welcome to the Shikasa Bu Motor Channel. This channel provides easy-to-understand explanations of car mechanisms. Inside engines, metal components rapidly rub against each other, causing wear and generating heat. In the combustion chamber, combustion of fuel generates soot, particulate matter, and other contaminants. Furthermore, since the metal inside the engine is constantly exposed to air, there is a risk of rust and corrosion. To prevent and reduce these issues, engine oil circulates inside the engine. This video explains the engine lubrication system and the viscosity characteristics of engine oil. Inside an engine, the oil pump draws up engine oil and supplies it to sliding components, such as the crankshaft and camshaft, providing lubrication. To make it easier to understand, we will use a schematic diagram. Engine oil is always stored in the oil pan. The oil strainer, which is a mesh-type filter, captures large foreign objects such as sludge clumps and fragments of liquid gasket. The oil suction port is designed to be positioned below the oil level when the engine oil is at the specified level. The oil pump pressurizes and delivers the engine oil, which has been filtered by the oil strainer, to various parts of the engine. There are three types of oil pumps used in engines: trochoid type, gear type, and crescent type. Based on various factors such as manufacturing cost, discharge capacity, and mechanical losses, engine designers select the most suitable type of oil pump for each engine. The oil pump is driven by the crankshaft via a chain or a gear shaft. Some engines are equipped with an oil cooler, downstream of the oil pump. The optimal operating temperature for engine oil is considered to be around 90 to 100 degrees Celsius. So an oil cooler is necessary for engines that frequently operate at high rotational speeds and under heavy loads. There are two types of oil coolers, liquid-cooled and air-cooled. The liquid-cooled type cools the engine oil using the engine coolant. Thanks to its excellent heat exchange efficiency, it is compact and offers flexibility in installation location. Since it is cooled by engine coolant, which normally operates at around 80 degrees Celsius, its cooling performance is inferior to that of the air-cooled type. The air-cooled type is installed in the front openings of the vehicle and cools the engine oil using the airflow generated while driving. It cools the engine oil using outside air, which is cooler than the engine coolant, resulting in superior cooling performance. Since it needs to be exposed to the airflow, its installation location is limited. In some cases, measures to prevent overcooling are necessary. The oil filter removes small debris and metal particles from the oil before it is delivered to moving parts. There are two types of oil filters: the cartridge type, where only the filter paper can be replaced, and the spin-on type, which integrates the filter paper, outer case, and relief valve into a unit. The filtered oil is supplied through the oil gallery in the cylinder block to reach the crankshaft main journals. The parts of the crankshaft that are supported by the cylinder block are called main journals. In the main journal, the crankshaft is supported by an oil film between it and the journal bearing, ensuring lubrication while also withstanding the combustion pressure. The clearance between the main journal and the bearing is critical for proper oil film formation. While it varies depending on the engine, it is generally in the range of 0.02 to 0.05 mm. Excessively small bearing clearance can cause metal surfaces to come into contact, potentially resulting in a serious seizure. If the clearance is too large, oil will escape, leading to a drop in oil pressure. The crank pin journal is the section of the crankshaft that connects to the connecting rod. Oil is supplied to the crank pin journal from the main journal through the oil passage inside the crankshaft. Similar to the main journal, the crank pin journal uses a bearing to form an oil film and provide lubrication. In some engines, oil supplied to the crank pin journal is injected through the oil passages in the connecting rod to cool the piston. In other types of engines, equip dedicated oil jets that sprays oil from the oil gallery towards the backside of the piston. The oil in the oil gallery is also sent to the cylinder head. The oil pressure fed to the cylinder head is partially directed to the camshaft holders to lubricate the camshaft, while the remainder is retained within the cylinder head. Camshaft lubrication can be classified into two types: one in which oil is supplied to each holder through oil passages inside the camshaft, and another in which oil is supplied to each holder from the cylinder head. The cam and tappet are lubricated by oil splashed inside the cylinder head. The piston and cylinder wall are lubricated by oil splashed up by the crankshaft counterweights or sprayed by oil jets. To prevent the oil that lubricates the piston from entering the combustion chamber, it is scraped down by the piston rings and returned to the oil pan. Engine oil not only lubricates the internal components of the engine, but also provides lubrication for the turbocharger. Additionally, it is used as hydraulic fluid for operating components, such as valve lash adjusters, chain tensioners, and variable valve timing mechanisms. The oil that has lubricated engine components drips down by gravity and returns to the oil pan. When the oil temperature is within the normal range, an oil pressure of 3 to 5 kg per square centimeter is considered normal. Since oil pressure fluctuates due to various factors while the engine is running, several control valves are installed to maintain it within the specified range. The oil pressure control valve is regulated by the balance between spring force and oil pressure. The control valve is subjected to both oil pressure and spring force. When the spring force is greater than the oil pressure, the valve remains closed. When the oil pressure exceeds the spring force, the spring is compressed, opening the oil passage and relieving pressure to prevent it from exceeding the specified level. As the engine speed increases and the oil pump speed rises, the discharge volume increases, causing the oil pressure in the circuit to rise. When the oil pressure exceeds a certain value, the pressure regulator valve opens, and some of the oil is returned to the oil pan to maintain the pressure at the specified level. When the outside temperature is low and the oil viscosity is high, or if a blockage occurs in the oil cooler causing the oil pressure to rise, the oil cooler bypass valve opens. If the filter element in the oil filter becomes clogged and oil can no longer pass through, the relief valve opens, allowing the oil to bypass the filter and be delivered to various parts of the engine. Although dirty oil ends up circulating through the engine, it helps prevent the worst-case scenario of engine seizure due to oil starvation. When blockages occur in the oil passages within the engine, leading to increase in circuit oil pressure, the pressure relief valve opens to prevent excessive pressure buildup. When oil pressure drops due to a leak or a low oil level, the oil pressure switch detects it and turns on the warning light on the instrument panel. There are two methods of the oil circulation system: wet sump system and dry sump system. In general, passenger car engines use a wet sump system, but some high-performance cars, such as those from Porsche and Ferrari, use engines with a dry sump system. In the wet sump system, oil accumulated in the oil pan is supplied to sliding components through an oil pump. In the dry sump system, the oil in the oil pan is suctioned up by a scavenging pump and stored in a reservoir tank. The feed pump supplies the oil in the reservoir tank to sliding components. The dry sump system has two main advantages. It prevents lubrication failure during cornering, and it reduces resistance caused by oil coming into contact with the rotating crankshaft. During high-speed cornering, high lateral G-forces are applied, causing the oil in the oil pan is pushed to one side. In a wet sump system, the oil pump may fail to draw up oil, which can lead to engine seizure. In a dry sump system, the scavenging pump cannot draw up oil, but since it can't supply oil from the reservoir tank, engine seizure does not occur. In a wet sump system, the crankshaft splashes oil from the oil pan to lubricate the inside of the cylinder block, but this creates resistance to the crankshaft's rotation. In a dry sump system, this is not necessary. For these reasons, dry sump systems are well suited for high-performance engines, but they come with higher costs. We will learn about the SAE oil viscosity standards. Oil viscosity is a measure of the oil's resistance to flow. Low viscosity oil is thinner and flows more easily, while high viscosity oil is thicker and flows less easily. 0W20 and 15W40, as displayed on oil cans, are SAE viscosity ratings that indicate the oil's thickness at very low and high temperatures. The number with the W before the hyphen indicates the oil's viscosity at very low temperatures, while the number after the hyphen represents its viscosity at 100 degrees Celsius. Let's compare the viscosities of 0W20 and 15W40. CCS stands for cold cranking simulator, and it indicates how difficult it is for the engine to crank using the starter motor in cold conditions. A lower viscosity value indicates that the oil is thinner. It can be seen that 0W20 at minus 35 degrees Celsius is thinner than 15W40 at minus 20 degrees Celsius. Pumping viscosity indicates the resistance the oil pump faces when drawing in oil. It can be seen that the viscosity of 0W20 at minus 40 degrees Celsius is the same as that of 15W40 at minus 25 degrees Celsius. At minus 30 degrees Celsius, while it's possible to start the engine with 0W20, it would be difficult to do so with 15W40. Viscosity at high temperatures is expressed as kinematic viscosity at 100 degrees Celsius. A lower viscosity value indicates that the oil is thinner. If the oil viscosity is too low, it becomes difficult to form an oil film, which in the worst case can lead to engine seizure. So, which oil viscosity should we choose? For general use, there's no problem as long as you use the oil recommended by the car manufacturer. However, let's say you live in a warm region and take a drive to an extremely cold area. The next morning, after spending a night at a hotel, you might find yourself at a loss in the parking lot. Also, if you take your everyday car to a track day with low viscosity oil, you might end up riding home in the passenger seat of a tow truck. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing to the channel. We'll see you in the next video.